Welcome back, everybody, to the Digital Democracy Summer School at the University of Rijeka in the Center for Advanced Studies, Southeast Europe. We are extremely privileged to have us with Professor Walter Quattriotti, sorry for butchering the name. He's a professor at the Sapienza University of Rome, leading the Center of Data Science and Complexity for Society. His research interests include data science, network science, cognitive science, and data-driven modeling of dynamic processes in complex networks. His activity focuses on the data-driven modeling of social dynamics, such as misinformation spreading and the emergence of collective phenomena. He has published extensively in peer-reviewed conferences and journals. His research in misinformation spreading has informed the Global Risk Report of the World Economic Forum, has been covered extensively in international media, and I could go on, but not to spend any more of your time. I give the floor to him with the title, How to Enhance the Public Sphere, Challenges and Perspectives. Thank you very much for being with us, and the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. So, as a first preliminary, can you hear me? Can you hear me pretty well, or?
Yes, quite well, I think.
Okay, perfect. Yeah. So the approach, I mean, let the context. I come from the computer science. I have a PhD in computer science. Then I study a little bit of psychology. And then I was given as a victim for a sacrifice for the interdisciplinary research to work with the idea to work with physicists. So my challenge at the beginning was to fill the gap between social science and physics. I totally failed. There were no option for the two worlds to communicate. Humanities and quantitative studies were pretty far at the time. We are talking about 8 years ago right now. And however, the approach is the mathematical formulation of complex phenomena in the paradigm of complex system. That is basically, we will focus on interaction between entities and we study the evolution of massive interaction. And we applied this to the frame of fake news diffusion. Now, let me say that to me, the problem of fake news is not correct defined, is not correctly defined. So can I ask you, what is your idea about the fake news problem? Why it is a problem, the problem of fake news?
Well, for me, it's about self-rule. As I come from a background of democratic theory and epistemic democracy, for me, if people are misinformed, then they cannot perform their autonomy fully, more meaningfully. So they will be, they can vote for something other than they would have if they would have known something more accurately. That is maybe for me the first.
No. So for you, the definition of the problem of fake news is correct. That's your point.
Come again, sorry.
The problem of fake news, the fake news problem is correctly defined. Or not?
I'm not sure what would be the standard definition.
The standard definition is that you have fake news and real news spreading on social
media. Okay. When it's so, like, if it's only fake news and only real news, then no, then it's not, then it's simplistic.
Yeah, it's silly, such a kind of definition. I mean, we are blaming social media and fake news because of Brexit, because of the election of Trump, and blah, blah. It's a kind of conspiracy theory, and I will show you, hopefully, why. This is a fake news, according to the definition of the existence of real news and fake news. How does it, how this image belong, to which class this image belong to? Is it fake or real?
I don't know. Me neither.
This is fake or real?
Yeah, again.
Me neither. And this one?
Fake.
This is fake, totally fake. And I totally agree that it's fake, but I shared it on Facebook because it is funny. The first point is that social media platforms are not intended to inform, are intended for spare time, to have fun. So it's easy that you go to spread something that is not totally real, totally fact-checked, because you spend your time over there, your spare time over there. So social media platforms are intended to entertain the user. That's the first point. Second point, the concept of truth evolve over time. Those are slogan, spot, advertisement for the saying basically that the good radioactive properties of chocolate, water, and soap. Those were advertisement of the 40s of last year, of last century. 8 years ago, it was feasible to say that chocolate is good because it is radioactive. Then there were Fukushima, Chernobyl, and so it's not so good to say that, okay, in this context. So this concept of reality changed over time. And that's the story. The scientific truth is temporarily truth, in a sense that we don't have a complete vision on what is going on because our approach to reality is bounded by our senses. So the idea of something totally true and totally fake is difficult to manage in defining a problem. To an extent that we are not able to accept this kind of issue, to an extent that in 2016, the Oxford Dictionaries elected like word of the year post-truth. What does it mean? Mean that people are more influenced by emotions rather than objective facts. So the human being is not rational. Good. So we discovered in 2016 that some way scared by the fact that the human being is not rational in 2016. Wonderful. No? So our idea was the approach was mainly to stop bullshitting, speculating about the story of fake news and trying to design a couple of experiment on massive data set in order to understand how information spread online, more than talking about blah, 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 about fake news and Brexit and blah, blah. The idea was not mine. It was from David Lazar that published a paper on science in 2009, basically proposing to address challenges coming from the social science by means of unquantitative approach based on computer science, physics, and more or less mathematics. That's the idea. Even because we have a problem of methodological problem from the psychology and from behavioral economics. A huge fraction of the studies published in these fields lack reproducibility of the experiments. So it is a problem. If you do the same experiment, you will not have the same result. That's a problem. So our approach was to apply massively tools from computer science and physics to try to address and to solve these methodological issues. We failed, let me anticipate this, because it's still far from to have a complete understanding of what is going on, but something went better. Let's start by the theoretical framework of the story. The theoretical framework of the story is that we can start by observing and asking and interacting with people from the humanities. And to me, the first point was to discover that from the humanities, most of the studies define a theory without the data. While for our approach is totally, is the opposite. We start from the data in order to draft a little something. A theory, something that is close to a theory. And we discovered that there is this theory of the agenda setting. The agenda setting theory states that the more a news is covered by the media, the more it is perceived to be important by the user. Okay, so if we will talk a lot about COVID-19, we will perceive COVID-19 like an important issue. And then with the advent of social media, something changed. Such a role of filter, the information, the agenda, the discussion of the audience that was given to the journalist, with the advent of social media, became a kind of bottom-up process because the trending topic are elected by the mass, so by the number of likes, by the number of comments, putting apart the role of journalists in this issue. Indeed, it was intended. Zuckerberg in 2007 said, what we are trying to do is just to make easy for people to communicate, get information, and share information. So basically, he is saying, we want to put this power of the agenda setting out of the control of the journalist and put it on the audience. This is the second important point. Platform, the first one was platform are intended for entertainment. Second point, those platforms give the power of the agenda of the discussion to the audience, not to the journalist. So there is no mediation anymore, to an extent that we call this transformation, this intermediation. The problem is on the quality of the information, because a lot of users propose information. What we miss is a quality check on the information space. What is a fake news at this point? Fake news are processes happening online that alter the initial statement of an information. So basically is a side effect of a really entropic system. Information ecosystem, when the information ecosystem collapsed on social media, the complexity and the noise of the system exploded. Just to give you an example, an anecdotal example, it was 2015, Quantico University. There was a press room where the journalists were defining, basically, were announcing to the audience that there will be, in a short time span, a military exercise in Texas. Military exercise in Texas. There were there journalists live tweeting about the event and reporting the news. Military exercise in Texas became Obama want to take over Texas. We believe in that almost everyone, even the governor of Texas, Greg Abbott, alerted the National Guard to look at the borders because there was this rumor about the idea that Obama want to take over, to invade Texas with the army. And another problem is that we always like to think that there are a portion of the population, there are specific profiles that are more prone to end up in engaging with fake news. While this is not the case, we are all susceptible to be decepted. This is a nice example. This is an interview of mine on an Italian newspaper talking about technology. So it's a journal for jerk. And I give an interview to the journal about presenting one study where we show that basically if you look at conspiracy, people consuming conspiracy theories, they behave almost at the same, everyone. So there is no differences in the way they treat with information. By looking at the comment on the story, I end up in looking at a comment. I was attracted by a comment where a guy was telling, oh, so how much conspiracy guys are stupid because they are closing their self-loop of auto-self-disinformation. Pathetic. That's his definition of me, with my name in clear, I was even the one interviewed, so my name was mentioned in the inquiry several times. I asked to the guy, oh, so do you think that you are better than us just because you follow official information sources? Wake up. such a wake up was for him the trigger for the bias, because he was looking to blast conspiracy theorists, and I proposed myself like to be a conspiracy theorist, but while I was the one interviewed in the paper he was commenting. And the problem is that he asked to me just three minutes later, oh, you not even read the paper. I didn't read the paper. I was the one in the interview. He was not able to match my name, the one on the comments, with the one on the journal. So probably he was the one not reading the paper. It took 20 minutes to us to make him understand that he was trolled. But still, you see, we like to think that the other are stupid and we are the good guy facing the truth. That's a huge bias, because our perception, our construction of reality, you know, is an approximation passing through sensory data. So for instance, if I ask you which one in the of the circle in the center is bigger, what is your answer? There is anybody in there?
We know they have the same size.
We know, but your perception is that the one on the right is bigger.
Right.
Yeah. So you see, our construction of reality is, our perception of reality can be biased. And this is happening several times. We tend to fill gaps where there are no lines. For instance, here there are no triangles, but we tend to see triangles in this issue. And this is maximized on social media because we miss a lot of information of the context. And so it's really easy to troll, to exploit these biases in order to deceive people. What we did, our study, was to troll users online to understand how information spread on social media. Yeah, the real question was, does confirmation bias, so the tendency to acquire information adhering to our system of belief and to ignore dissenting information, dominates online content consumption? Those was the question. The question was addressed by building an experimental setting, a really simple experimental setting. Basically, it is on Facebook. We collected data from scientific pages, so pages promoting information from science papers mostly, and collecting all the information about conspiracy pages, conspiracy information. What we found is that the users that consume information, scientific information, just follow scientific information and are linked with people following scientific information, and people following conspiracy theories interact mainly with people that are following conspiracy theories. So the idea of echo chamber. The experiment was, once I identified one guy from the conspiracy side, how does he respond to information adhering to his system of belief, even if those contain fake information? First question. The second question, how would the guy respond to information dissenting his narrative? So to just to have an example, if I'm a supporter of Flat Earth, how would I respond to an information telling me that sure, the heart is flat and even my foot are flat? So this is the troll, the positive feedback. And how does it respond to an information telling that the heart is not flat? Simply fact check the information. As I anticipated, they divided in blocks. They tend to cluster together. Scientific guys with scientific guys, conspiracy guy with conspiracy guy. So this is the idea behind the echo chamber effect. The conspiracy guy interact with the information adhering to their system of belief, even if those contain false claims. They don't care about the total value of the information. How they respond for information dissenting their narrative the reaction is not to engage, is to filter out those kind of information. Only a few fraction of the conspiracy guy, the one in green, will interact with the banking information, but after the exposure, they will be will be more active in consuming conspiracy content. So basically, it triggers a kind of backfire. This was able to give us two important data points to model the spread of information online. And what we found is that basically information remains confined within the echo chamber. For this, the problem of fake news is not well formulated, because information follows a kind of coherence with the narrative of the users. So it's not a matter of truth value of the information, it's a matter of homophily of the news with the shared narrative within the group. There are groups that are more prone to acquire specific kind of information according to the narrative they are usually exposed to, and totally interested in information coming from other sites. So there is no way to solve the problem of fake news with fact-checking. We know this since 7 years. Now everyone is, now even the scientific, there is agreement, consensus in this on the scientific field, more or less. Last point of the model is that the more we are engaged in these clusters, in these tribes, the more we tend to be negative. So this is the kind of the Godwin law. The more the conversation advances online, the higher the probability to be toxic in the comments we express. And this is validated in the echo chamber. The more we are immersed in an echo chamber, the more negative is gonna be the kind of comment and sentiment expressing in the comment by the users. That's a fair point. So basically, let's summarize. We have a large amount of information circulating in a totally disintermediated environment where the main goal is to entertain people, not to inform people. What happens over there is that we tend to cluster together. We acquire information adhering to our system of belief. We ignore dissenting information. And the more we are set in this loop, the more we tend to be negative. So it kind of, no, there is no way to be free in this issue. We extended this model to other sources to validate the hypothesis that we tend to polarize and cluster in echo chamber. So we addressed this study in 2017 about news consumption on social media, especially on Facebook. We analyzed the behavior of 376 million of users over a 6-year time span. And what we found is that the more the users are active, the less number of sources they follow. What does it mean? That we tend to filter out the information we don't like. And that's the point. This creates a really polarized environment. So we found a polarized environment in the Brexit debate, Remainers with Remainers, Brexiters with Brexiters, on the anti-vaxxer or pro-vaxxer stuff, it is almost the same. Pro-vax with pro-vax, anti-vax with anti-vax. They tend to cluster together, acquire information adhering to their system of belief, ignoring dissenting information. So basically this model is kind of universal. To an extent that I proposed in 2017 to the World Economic Forum to not look to fake news and fact-checking, but look to polarizing topics, because a polarizing topic has the probability of the 93% to be a topic of fake news in the next 24 hours. And that's a pointer, but at the time we were still in love, still desperated thinking to the possible option of the fact-checking. Last point that we, another point we added in this research, it was last year, we published this paper on PNIS where we compared the polarizing dynamics on different social media. In particular, we pick Gab, Twitter, Facebook, and Reddit, and we compare the tendency to cluster of the users online. What we found, the plots are really easy to read. -1 is far left, 1 is far right. On the x-axis is my leaning. On the y-axis, we have the leaning of my neighbors. So if we have colors on the diagonal, we are in a polarized environment. It means that we tend to cluster with people having our own profile. And we found that mainstream platforms like Twitter and Facebook, that are even the platform using feed algorithm trying to maximize the targeting of the users, tend to be more polarized than Reddit and Gab that are not using such a kind of algorithm. So this means that this algorithm falls for the echo chamber effect? No, but this is a data point in that direction. This is the group that was behind this story. The coverage of the stuff was huge, massive, but still we think that the fact-checking will solve the problem of fake news. We informed the Global Risk Report of 2016, 2017, blah, blah. Then it was the time of the COVID-19. COVID-19 was the perfect storm to measure how people react to external threats, treats like an epidemic, a global pandemic. And so what we did was another popular paper. It received tons of citations. I was not expecting to have all this citation, how much it is stupid, the kind of analysis we did. Basically, we analyzed the people on different social media, how people were looking information about COVID-19 in the early 1 month, 2 months of the pandemic. And what we found was a confirmation of the echo chamber effect, nothing special. There were different searches looking for homophilies, looking for information adhering to their system of belief and ignoring the scientific information. But there were no differences between news according to their reliability score. So the reliability doesn't matter for the spreading process. And this was really, really engaging for the G7 because I received an email after the paper, a month after the paper. Someone from the G7 read the paper and asked me to expand the research to build a research coalition to study the misinformation problem. And we are running this issue with the World Health Organization, various CDC around the globe. And we have published it. The slides are not updated. The paper is Infodemic and New Challenge for Public Health and has been published on Cell in December. And basically we defined infodemic in a way that we can replace the wrong definition of fake news. In a sense that infodemic is overabundance of information that triggers confirmation bias, echo chambers, and group polarization. That was the issue. We were mentioned in G7, the leader statement, because we have to focus especially on important topic like vaccine hesitancy or vaccine acceptance, depending on the echo chamber you belong to. And climate change. The partners I'm coordinating the data analysis side from Sapienza. This involved three universities, Ca' Foscari University of Venice and the Alan Turing Institute. Then we have the University of Cambridge that discovered the psychological part. Then we have the Harvard University that discovered the communication part and the London School of Hygiene that discovered the anthropological part with Heidi Larson. The first experiment we did is to measure if the infodemics existed about vaccine. Yes, there were an overabundance of information about vaccine when AstraZeneca and Pfizer were announced to the social media. So a lot of information, but such an explosion of information didn't affect the vaccine hesitancy. People that were willing to vaccinate were still willing to vaccinate. People not willing to vaccinate were still remain of the situation. So basically, infodemics just created a crystallization of the opinions. Doesn't change the mood of people. And that's all. We are advancing. We are proposing new papers. There will be soon another paper about climate change, the polarization of climate change, still finding the same stuff. The more we talk about something, the more we tend to polarize. And that's all, basically. I'm done.
Thank you very much for this really interesting and rich talk. So much information to take in. And I open the floor to questions and see if anyone has already raised a hand. If not yet, at least not in Zoom, I don't see. I would ask about one of the last slides, if I noticed correctly, whether the vaccine hesitancy poll or like if the information they receive changed their attitude, was the I didn't quite see the dates of the poll or the study happening. It seemed to me as if it was 23rd of January to 30th of January. So was it like a week or is it a mistake? Was it a long it?
No, no, it was a longer time. No, I mean, it's the overall time span. It's a huge survey with 1,600,000 users, so on 8 different countries.
And okay, basically, okay.
There is no change in the curve of the. There is some fluctuation, so this means that it's sensitive to information, but basically it doesn't change the acceptance rate. The acceptance rates remain fixed.
Great, not great, but good to know. Marco Luca has raised his hand, so I will not abuse my privilege as a moderator and give word to him.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the talk. I have like a ton of questions, but I will sort of try to focus on three of them. So first one is just with regards to the first research that you mentioned when you gave sort of conspiracy theory people information that fit their worldview, the falsity didn't matter. But was this the same with the science people? So it was the same kind of effect? Did they also just take in false info?
Mm-hmm. I don't have an experiment on that. Mm-hmm. I have just the qualitative experience that yes, it is like this, but it's only the qualitative side. The analysis was given on the conspiracy side. On the
conspiracy side. Mm-hmm. I see.
It's even the same for the opposite. I mean,
mm-hmm.
Totally.
And sort of with regards to the basically echo chamber effect, the could you maybe just share some ideas of policy recommendations that you were giving and how are they come? You said that people that the sort of super.
There is. I'm drafting the policy recommendation for the mm-hmm. for this to present it to the G7. But basically, the policy recommendation is that until we will have the business model of platform focused on the maximization of the entertainment, this problem of polarization will not be solved. That's the so basically, at least we have the problem.
I see. Yeah, I find it really interesting this point that you said that social media are supposed to be like free, basically leisure, this entertainment, right? And yet Zuckerberg did mention that they wanted to for them to be sort of information sharing sites. So it's really interesting we had recently a seminar with Christopher T. Nguyen, who is working on this problem of gamification of public discourse when it happens. And he says that games are great. I mean, because you know you're in a game, and when you're in a sort of game-like environment in which you don't actually treat as a game, this is when the break happens.
That's what is happening.
Super. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. And the next question is from Emilia Marra.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Super. Okay, so thank you very much. I just have a follow-up question, nothing big, but I'd like you to spend a couple of words more on the concept of troll, because you said correctly that fake news has plural definitions. So I'd like to know if this is the case also for troll and trolling, or if in the case of troll and trolling, we do have one definition. Thank you.
Do you refer to the definition of the European Commission about fake news, misinformation, disinformation, and blah, blah? Are you?
Just just about the use that you did in your presentation, because you clarified immediately that fake news has to be taken with a couple of things in mind, knowing that there are not just one definition. So I was wondering on the other side, what about trolling?
Actually, trolling is an action of deception that could be just for fun or to be malicious. So it perfectly fit in the definition of disinformation. I really don't like the definition of misinformation provided by the European Commission because it's too theoretical. You know, it's not touching the point. It's totally misleading in this context because actually we miss the point that most of the time trolling or intentional act to disinform use and exploit the entropy of the social media. So we have to consider all the components in which the layers in which this can happen. So trolling is one way to trigger this this way. You can do it for manipulating the public opinion in terms of the election. You can do it just for fun. And the results can be more or less the same, even using bots, no? Bots for the automatic, for the promotion and cheating on the algorithm. That's are all way to challenge, exploit the polarization and confirmation bias of people. That's the basic tool. For this, I would like to have less theory and more data analytics, because otherwise we run up in circle providing definition, looking for definition, but we miss the point on what is happening in the wild. I don't know if this answers.
Yeah, it does. But I was just thinking that fake news is about things, it's about information, it's about articles, it's about something. What I find interesting about trolling is that it's about the relationship between users. So I think that's an important difference.
I don't think so at all, because the communication, the interaction happens through information. So you can trigger information even through, I mean, the idea of fake news is totally bogus, because you basically are saying that you can frame a story by saying that it is really accurate because a journalist checked it. But a journalist is a human being with a lot of biases, and they can bullshitting a lot of times. So there is a lot of inaccurate information spreading on that side. So playing with this reliability score, there was a paper published on Science Advances 3 days ago that is showing that putting this label of the fact-checking stuff on the fake news doesn't play any role in changing the misperception. So that's, you know, the problem is more complicated than the idea. So limiting the idea of rumor just to fake news and we can verify the news through journalists, to me, is wrong.
Yeah, I do agree with this. It's not what I was proposing, actually. I was thinking that a fake news potentially can exist without readers. So I can just write down a fake news without sharing it. It is still a fake news. But if I want to do some trolling, I do need another user. This is what I was thinking.
Yeah, but fake news as a problem exists because of the spreading of fake news. So spreading is actually a collective process. So it's mandatory to have someone. I mean, it's not a problem of lies. It's a problem of the entropy that you can trigger. You can trigger new phenomena through this information ecosystem that is really full of noise. Still, you're still there.
Sure. Thanks.
Thank you. Walter, a very simple question: how can echo chamber be reduced? Do you have any idea?
Do you really want to be engaged with someone that is not is against your stuff, is not in your mind, is against you? Do you want to be engaged? I don't.
Okay.
I love my echo chamber. So it's there are some attempt to draft some stories, but by improving the number of differentiating views and so on. But this basically is another stupid way to approach the problem, because the echo chamber doesn't mean that I'm following just the stuff I like. It means that I'm interpreting the information I receive in a precise setting, in a precise frame. So if I have an echo chamber, the echo chamber will draft news from the far right or from the far left in a way that are consistent with the shared narrative. So it's not a matter of introducing more information, more heterogeneous information, is a problem of breaking the echo chamber by starting to exchange information. But what we saw is that the more you discuss online, the more you tend to be negative. So why we should get rid of echo chamber? I feel really comfortable in my echo chamber. That's my answer.
Thank you for the answer and the clarifications. I don't see a raised hand quite yet, but so I will try to ask if I understand correctly that your opposition, I think you have two oppositions to the term fake news. One is that it has an idealistic idea of traditional news as being objective and like in a too strict way. But I would assume that you don't argue, let's say, instead of objective, we say intersubjective, and instead of true and right, we say trying to, for example, give both sides, if there are two sides of, let's say, a conflict, both sides an answer, all this, you know, traditional journalistic standards, so that you wouldn't oppose saying that there are better journalistic standards and less, not claiming that one is objectively true and one is objectively false. So that's like the first, your first critique of the term was that, and the second one was that it's misleading about what the infodemic is about, as if it would be about the first thing or that factfulness, rather it's about polarizing emotions and hooking and framing. And in this sense, when Emilia, I think, asked about the trolling and said that fake news is about facts or like claims about news, I don't think it is only trolling is about relations, but fake news is also about how does this make me feel. And I want those news not because I might care that deeply if they're right or wrong, but rather how does it make me feel. And it's a very why do I have confirmation bias? Because I want to feel validated by the outside information that what I previously thought was right. So, you know, that's a flattering thing and so on. So I think it's also very emotional. Did I understand that that's your second, you know, objection to framing the question in terms of fake news and right news, that it is actually a much more deeper, let's say, psychological phenomenon that we all have, due to, you know, our inherent cognitive biases, which are in part good and in part troublesome. Did I catch that right?
Well, no. I'm actually, my position is not totally extreme. I'm saying that we should increase the journalistic standards in terms of contrasting the diffusion of fake news and contrast. Especially, another point is to address the awareness of our biases, even on the journalistic side, to be aware of the processes we are active on online. We have a recent project with the Radio Italian National Television to in this direction. The problem is that journalists think that they know everything about the world. That's a problem. It's a problem by the beginning. Then I told you, I don't have a precise stance about the problem. I don't like to have too many definitions. Yes, otherwise I feel I don't know how to represent data, and we end up in the bias of creating first the theory and then looking for the data that are gonna fit the theory. That's the my point. Until now, what I can say is that the environment online is really polarized. The action of trolling is pretty similar to the one of the deception, because they want to decept people. Actually, there is no way, no other way around. They can play on the psychological side, both with news and both with interactions. But most of the memes that went popular were jokes on with memes and with news and this kind of stuff. So I don't think that there is a strict difference, at least on the users' perspective, about the content circulating online. They don't care if it is a news or it is a post from someone. It's the same asking for the attention span of the user. That's the point. For this, I was saying that labeling the content with this is really accurate or not doesn't change at all the media diet of the users. That was, I don't know if I give the frame because it's complex. I mean, so just to be safe, I'm not one of the supporters of the relativism, total relativism, and so on. I'm just saying that the situation is really complicated, and we have to be really aware and pay attention to not create too much noise over noise with the rumors and definitions that are not compliant with what we are observing. For instance, as I told you, the definition, the five definition of different kind of misinformation provided by the European Commission to me is totally nonsense in this kind of way, because it's an heuristic to explain something that we didn't understood correctly at this point. So it's better to avoid names at the stage and let's to have a better focus on what is happening ongoing. But you know, it's my opinion. This one is my opinion.
Thank you very much for the clarifications. Again, there's a raised hand by Mariana.
Yes, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
But, I have a question that is based on a group that I follow on Facebook, which is actually falls into the category of the middle ground when we talk about the trolling and the fake news. It's a group of students who actually responded to one specific page on the Facebook, which is dedicated to spread the far right idea of nationalism, and how far the nation is through history existed, which is completely bogus. It's mythical, literally, in their beliefs. And the student group that actually plays the Mythbusters, and they are somewhere in the middle ground, because the both sides are on the page of the students and discuss their beliefs. How much of trolling we can expect from both groups at one point, because they both go to the extremes to prove their point and their belief. And can we expect more of those kind of groups in the future on spaces like on platforms like Facebook or other places?
Well, in what I can say on this in this direction, I mean, it's on average, on the big numbers, what happens is that there is polarization, but it is a stochastic process, so it is statistical, and sometimes something different may happen in this story. However, the more we are engaged over online, the more it seems that we tend to have this kind of self-confirmation hypothesis that probably is even linked with something identitarian. In the, so we want to feel this because we think to be like this. That's a serious problem. And I don't know. I didn't explore the this kind of studies you were mentioning. So I'm not so much aware of this kind of experiment. That's my fault.
No, it's not a problem. It's not an experiment. I stumbled on that. On that page, and it was interesting to me to see the coexistence of two opposite groups in the same place, because usually we do tend to spread in echo chambers.
Yeah, of course.
Gravitate toward the people of same opinion.
Actually, there was some studies from Stanford, if I remember well, that basically they were looking that the polarization is more likely to happen when the topic of the discussion is really precious for you. So it's really precious for the users. So if we are talking about something general, we tend to be more open-minded and more flexible. When we are talking with something that is closer to us, so narrower, for instance, getting a vaccination, something like this, we tend to be really more emotional and more prone. So it may depends on the topic of the discussion.
Thank you.
Thank you. Does anyone have any more questions?
I just like to ask just one little detail. When you were talking about infodemics, you mentioned that it's overabundance of information. And I was just wondering, what does this, what is overabundance in a sense? How do we determine what is the sufficient amount of information or too much information? I'm not clear on this.
You never deal with the people from the WHO, right? Okay, so you are lucky. They're like,
So it's there, sort of input, this term of overabundance, because I'm aware of infodemics, and this term always bugged me.
Is the official definition of overabundance of information? I can agree that is a lot of information. Then how much no one give a quantity on the issue. We validated this trend with the infodemics about vaccine by looking that on Instagram and Facebook and Twitter, there were a huge amount of links, more than images. That is, on Facebook is strange, more than images about vaccines. So we thought that there were a lot of people looking for to fill the gap of the information voids. So there were this lack of information about vaccine, they were trying to fill this gap. So we say, okay, this probably is compliant with the general definition of infodemics. Does such a situation impacted on the as an impact on the user's tendency to vaccination? No, that was the proxy. Really simple. I do only simple stuff.
Thank you.
I don't see any raised hands, but maybe I could come back to Gabriele's question still, because it about reducing, however you would term the problematic effects of information spreading, and the, whether in terms of emotions, identity, polarizing, and so on. Because your answer was that why should we reduce echo chambers from like an individual rationality perspective? I like to be with my friends. That's why I'm with them. That's why I'm in my echo chamber of reasonable people who think like me, as that means reasonably. And that's fine, but of course it's obvious that this at sometimes has, and it has advantages and so on, but it has collective can have collective disadvantages. Clear with the vaccine examples, clear with people doing environmental harm if they choose to do so because they are misinformed or base their identity on not being the silly green person, and now with the Russian aggression to Ukraine, if people are receiving biased information, if they are polarized and so on. So like it has a lot of obvious social and collective consequences. So I think still it's not that easy to dismiss the, you know, the worry to what to do about it. So perhaps if we have still a little bit of time, and could you speculate, let's say, yes, even to you know, relax the demands of reasoning?
Actually, it's what we know so far is that fact checking doesn't work. That's a point. It's useful for the one that are already prone. So we need fact checking, of course. But it is useful for the one that are prone to receive it. It's not gonna change people's mind. That's obvious. We now at this stage we have two options: or we continue on the deficit model, so deficit model considering the other people stupid, basically, so people that are need to be informed with correct information, or we start to consider that people need a frame to change their mind, to trigger the, some changing. There are some studies we are collaborating with the University of Cambridge on this idea of the pre-banking stuff. So the idea is that once we understood through data analytics more or less what is the mood on the information space about a specific topic, to enter and provide a kind of frame, a narrative frame that is able to smooth polarization. That's the street we are trying, the stream we are trying so far, but I don't know if it is going to work. And in this direction, for sure, we there are problems arising from this new information environment. Definitely, a lot of problems. especially in the terms of vaccines, about the climate change, is a problem. There is a problem on the issue. How to change people's mind on social media, to me, is still far to be clear, in a sense that if we look for confirmation, if we acquire information confirming our point of view, we interact with people that tend to have our own point of view, we don't want to change our mind on social media. That's the first starting point. So for this, I'm saying that the deficit model is not going to work. We have to think something new in this direction, but I don't know what. I can provide the treatment in this kind of issue. I hope that the pre-banking stuff is working. I'm a little bit skeptical because of the idea of inoculating people. Strange. I don't like the idea of inoculating someone to change his mind. I mean, it's, I like the idea of freedom. I don't know. I don't like even the nudging approach, the one that is proposing the correct mental frame for, I think that is kind of manipulation. It's, I don't like it. It's, I'm more liberal, this kind of stuff. And however, it can be a study, there are some studies on this direction providing some interesting results, but still we don't have nothing that is able to say what is, which is the right way, the right path to be out of that. I propose it in different places that we should be more aware of our biases. So for instance, less work the media literacy in the direction of the awareness of our way of consuming information online. That's a point, but it's a little piece in a huge sea.
Thanks. I think little pieces might be all we have, and of course our goal, it might be that our goal is not to change someone's view, rather than like reduce the harming effects of polarization. For example, if we still have different views, but we understand and respect each other's views, or we have encountered them not in a caricatured way, for example,
yeah.
That might also have some benefits.
Definitely.
Okay. Definitely. Thank you very much for your talk and your presentation. It was really full of information. I hope to, since we recorded it, I hope to rewatch it and find some of the information maybe to use in critical thinking classes that I give. So thank you very much. And I will stop recording now and give.